Okay. Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's episode. I would like to begin this episode by sharing certain quotes from this technological futurist named Ray Kurzweil. He says, by the time we get to the 2040s, we'll be able to multiply human intelligence a billionfold. That will be a profound change that's singular in nature. Computers are going to keep getting smaller and smaller. Ultimately, they would go inside our bodies and brains and make us healthier, make us smarter. So we have a suggestion here from Ray Kurzweil that by the age of 2040, technology is going to be going in us. Right now, it's an external relationship, but it will go within in some sense. Ray Kurzweil says, when you talk to a human in 2035, you'll be talking to someone that's a combination of biological and non-biological intelligence. He says, by 2029, computers will have emotional intelligence and be convincing as people. Ray Kurzweil is one of the most notable scientists and future living today. What he says is true. You have to happen. It's as if you can see the clouds before the rain comes. So in this episode, I would like to discuss certain visions and ideology. That has come to me about how the experience of a natural life will transition into a technological one, and where are the dangers. You see, something very kind of ironic, the thing about technology is that there are many lost technologies. You can think of languages of technology and the scribes, those people who wrote books and passed them on, them being as if they are preventing the loss of many technologies. Someone once said there was like, I don't know, like 12 methods of flight and the wings of the plane was one of them. And so all the other methods stop as one innovation reaches the finish line and attains an efficiency of its task. So right now, I have considered humanity. I have considered that we have moved away from the nature, from a natural environment, from the food chain, from natural circumstances to controlled and conditioned circumstances. Right now I am sitting on the porch of my house, but thousands of years ago we would all be running everywhere. You know, it's as if the stature of the house, the civility, the sense of comfort, the sense of existential presence would be different. Sometimes inventions don't happen unless you move astray from the common typical thinking. I've had many conversations with people about this, and the end of the debate, it was pretty much that we both concluded that if you do the same thing as everyone else is doing, you will end up in the same place. And it's not a kind of sheep going to the slaughterhouse situation where you suddenly notice it. It's more like waste of efficiency. You as a human being, you have an energetic expression. This energetic expression tends to focus on self. We tend to just live for ourselves. But in some sense, we don't wonder about the future. And that is, in some sense, where inefficiency maximizes, kind of like you're in a car and you don't know where you're driving to, as if the species needs to just look at the front window and recognize where it's heading, and then it will act accordingly. So we cannot avoid a technological reality. How will it arise? You see, it will arise from an inner war. I believe this. I believe there will come an internal, moral, ethical, whatever you want to call it, psychological war, where the person has to accept the unnatural for the natural. I've written the script It's called Project 12. And it's something in the works. I'm working on producing it. And so the script idea is Project 12 is about two robots. It's about in the future. I don't remember what year I said. I think I said 2289. Ray Kurzweil says it's going to be much sooner, but that in my story, I predicted it that way. And so I thought that in the year 2229, as the story of Project 12, the script I've written goes, is that really every human being has become a robot, but it's as it started in a way where it's as if the dude was a human being and then he replaced his arm for a robotic arm, then he replaced his other arm for a robotic arm, then he replaced eventually most of his body. Eventually, at the end of it was like, okay, why not go full out? So you see, it's the desire of the access to the sort of expression that makes us be open to the technological interface replacing our bodies or not. So it has to do with desire. And the desire, we can see it comes from the story. It comes from the story of people's lives. And so the story nowadays is embrace of technology, because after all, evolutionary speaking, we were monkeys on trees and now we have computers in front of us. You know, we if this technology fascinates us to a degree that we may even replace ourselves. So in my story, Project 12, in the year 2289, all human life has legit transformed itself into robotic beings. So pretty much robots are acting like humans. And the whole story of Project 12 is this robot called Project 1, and this robot called Project 2. Project 2 comes and proposes to Project 1. A robot comes and proposes to a robot, and it's kind of hilarious how I've written it. It's as if the robot comes in and says to the female robot, requesting access to program marriage. And then the female robot says, access denied. And then the story says requesting access to project something like human life simulation. I don't remember how I wrote it. And so and so the robot then says access granted, the female robot. And it's pretty much this story of these two human beings who they are the two robots who go into a simulation of being a human being to see if they're compatible or not. Nature's embrace of technological realities is a suggestion that a natural being has to make a decision about how unnatural it wants to be and what the value is. Sometimes it's like technology. Some people have thought it could be the deal with the devil. What that means is like you're sacrificing something more valuable for a momentary reason. I find that there will come stories that will glorify human nature. Terence McKenna, in one of his lectures, the scholar and ethnobotanist, he says something very interesting. He said the poets have failed us. In his lecture, Opening the Doors of Creativity, he says the poets failed us. And I was like, what do you mean, man? And I realized the story of the world is not efficient, and thus the poets have failed. We're kind of going with the program, and that's the issue. When you go for the program too long, your intellectual faculties become dormant. When you have others thinking for you, you stop thinking for yourself, and there's a kind of death of an identity. But not, you see, a good way where the identity of the person dismantles is when they are humbled by an experiential truth of the world. Literally, the person has a certain set of beliefs. He gets angry. He gets resistant to the world. The world slams him down. He realizes, okay, my ideas, I've been taking them too seriously. That is the cause of violence, by the way. Ideas that are taken too seriously because the reality of the person has nothing else to do. It's as if it kind of like in my loneliness, my soul has kind of shed tears for this idea, but the fact that we human beings are more programmed than we think. I'm telling you, we behave like programs. But these programs are linguistic. The code, the language, it's not like code for computers, it's language. Language is our code. And so, on some level, it's a technology that must be protected and shielded from the disasters of the future. At the same time, We must not get too much technology in our system. In some sense, technology can be seen as a drug. I'm telling you. And it is not just a drug, it is a sort of strange evasion. That's the issue. If you notice, most addictions are evasions of the action of the moment. Literally, your time is spent towards inefficiency rather than efficiency. That's how you kind of round up your life. You make it efficient. You calculate what is efficient in your reality and you move forward until that sense of efficiency updates based on collective patterns. Ray Kurzweil has an interesting quote. He says, "New technologies can be used for destructive purposes. The answer is to develop rapid response systems for new dangers, like a bioterrorist creating a new biological virus." What that means is, yes, we need to have a shield in the spirit of our civilization. There are certain things we must protect, whether we like it or not. And then there are some things where we must fight for. So it's kind of strange. We don't know what will happen. Ray Kurzweil predicts this singularity happening. I think his accurate thing is by the year 2045, but I'm not sure if he's changed it. I want you to pay attention to the picture I've chosen. What you see in this picture is a civilization, a society that has embraced technology. It has embraced technology because the higher dimensions and access to various data has become crucial. You see, the information age kind of set the next era. Before, it was just about you could just be survival of the fittest. You could just be fit. You could just be like, strong and nothing would happen. You would live a good life. But you would see that nowadays it is all about data because the data can shift the environment, therefore, data has more power than the individual, in some sense, the having the right data at the right time. Without the faculty that learns from its mistakes, we would, in some sense, be an unevolved species. We adjust to the exposure that we get from life throughout the day. Easiest way to kind of function is to find the veil, or should I say, find a relationship with the natural world that at least signifies for you, makes it clear for you what is nature. Believe there are hidden mysteries in nature, but I've kind of, because our minds dabble with time. It's as if I've had certain hypotheses that I've made, and it's kind of like one of those Mr.Within theories in some sense, where I am saying the body goes from the past to the future, but the mind is coming from the future to the past. The mind doesn't have the same sort of linear restriction as the objective realm because it's usually a subjective phenomenon, time. Ray Kurzweil has this quote. He says, "A successful person isn't necessarily better than her less successful peers at solving problems. Her pattern recognition facilities have just learned what problems are worth solving." Very true. They say this, it's an ancient saying. They make you ask the wrong question. They don't have to worry about your answers. And what that means is like, you're looking for a busy market where there's a discount, and you ask someone, and that guy says, "The market's on somewhere else, man. You got to go ask people there," and sends you off a different direction, for example. This has never happened to me, but for some reason, that example came to my mind. And so, really, where is your attention going, dear human being? What is the value of humanity if it does not even protect its nature, its biological existence from its own self-induced technological invasion? Do you want the children of humanity to be machines? If you do, keep living the way you are. If not, you have to re-embrace nature somehow. We have to bring natural imagery. What that means is probably in the next 5 to 10 years, we even see it with video games. People's attention throughout the day is being drawn to pixelated simulations of worlds. What that means is, like, this is how you sell the world technology. You convince it that its mind requires the technology. That's the only way sales really works, to be honest. There's a need that's being answered. A need further than the emotions. It's as if when something makes sense, the person buys it. But the issue is, their senses are based on the data of that moment. So this natural phenomena became self-aware to a point where it's positioned subjectively and objectively. Literally, our moments as people in 2019, there is an objective component, the physical stuff. I'm sitting on my porch right now, physical body, da-da-da-da-da. And then there's the subjective realm. The subjective reality is where technology is being authorized to enter our lives. So what that means is you can no longer the spiritual task is to, in some sense, become enlightened. The spiritual task has become to realize what value is worth keeping. Because we live for ourselves, I mean, you can. Pretty much every creature on this planet has been living for itself since the beginning of its existence, but it gets boring. What I mean by that is, imagine people who went to work. The institution they were working for was changing the world in incredible ways. Right now, there's a sort of unnecessary greed that is keeping the world from its better possibilities. You will see people like this in your life, and the easiest way to handle them is to transform their mindset. Because it is easier to be selfish than selfless. It is easier to hate than to create. There has been days where I have asked myself why my breath is in my body. There has been times where I have wondered why existence is the way it is. And what happens is you realize the limits of your perception, and eventually you come to contentment with a certain range of data accessible. This range of data accessible to you, you have to pick and choose. The issue of our schools is they don't teach children to be problem solvers because the child is too pushed internally. Most children experience school hidden in their inner realms. They're just like behind their eyes, just chilling. And unfortunately, certain ways I've seen, it's the mob mentality. The mob mentality can totally destroy a person's value, and it can also recreate a person's value. And it all has to do a test of the moment. Now, I have to say this, that I have envisioned what it's going to be like. It's pretty much one of the works I've done in my science fiction novel, The Messenger of Giants. In this science fiction novel, I have shared the ideas of the first robots being sent into the educational system. And what that means is that unnatural enters the natural. Unknown factors emerge in known conditions. Sometimes. You must put down your ideology, look at the world, and for the first time appreciate its simplicity. Because we don't have contentment with living in simple ways, we escape through complexity. We want our lives to become complex before having truly observed the simple. And the simple is being forgotten, and those souls leaving their natural environments in the outskirts of town and coming to the city, they are understanding the transformation of character. They're understanding the transformation of the freedom that nature provides. It is the movement of man. Where we are heading dictates our world. Where we are heading dictates where we will be. And so, humanity has to put an effort. I mean, seriously, we are 8 billion people. We can't think of ways to recreate new dimensions of experiencing nature and the world and transforming violence and hostility into efficient games of that solve the world's problems. It's as if it's that one moment where one human being shouts. He shouts at the cosmos, and the cosmos hears it, and the cosmos is like, human being, why are you shouting? And the human being says, because greatness has opened its eyes, but it has not dared to move. Because we are here after billions of years and we think the journey was small, we think we are alive only from the moment we were born. No, we are the effort of our ancestors. We are the winds of evolution. We are the opportunity for human life to evolve. And so, it requires systems, it requires strategic movement, it requires human beings understanding the value of network and the value of networks in regards to language. So you see, the world is separated in language. The story of Babylon kind of predicted the future of the world. Not the future, predicted our current world. The story of Babylon is this ancient story. The story of Babylon, or the Tower of Babylon, is how all of humanity was united under one language and they started building this tower that reached the heavens because man, together united, had an attempt to reach the gods. They had an attempt to penetrate the unknown, the unconscious, and the endeavors of many philosophers on this planet. If you conclude all of life to be work rather than play, guess what? It's an infinitely expanding manifestation. Your existence is just work defined. Therefore, how can I tell you? If you go too much into stillness, it will dismantle your free will, ideological free will. If you go too much into movement, it will dismantle your ideological free will. Now, the dismantling of your ideological free will is not per se. Okay, so the stream is back or not? It says the stream is continuing. Okay. So, as all these human beings united under one language, united under one language, the tower gets higher and higher, and eventually the gods see human beings climbing up to the clouds, and one of the gods is about to throw lightning, and the other god's like, yo, chill, man, let me show you a classier way to do this. And what the god does is, the other god, is that he makes human beings speak different languages. The moment he makes human beings speak different languages, they cannot communicate together, therefore they do not have enough management to finish this tower that reached the heavens. This tower that reached the heavens is pretty much a story for the effort of conscious entities organized into a civilization. It's as if together we realize a strange power. You see how people have unknown factors in their life? Many people right now in the world are praying for a better tomorrow. this live stream is being cut up by bad Wi-Fi. And so there is this suggestion that there was a separation of an existential language, not an experiential language. Words are an experiential language. That's why they are in the texture of a kind of evocation. You bring words out of nowhere. Right now I'm speaking to you, it's as if silence, and then words are emerging. So it's a sort of emergence of abstract design into the environment. If you just sit down and be still and silent and just listen to people speak, you will see in what sequence their minds are bringing concepts. Therefore, you kind of see their inner pattern of how their approaches. Because a person's communication reflects their inner reality. Their inner reality, believe it or not, reflects how well they've comprehended external reality. So right now, the ending of the Tower of Babylon story is the same place we find ourselves now. Separated languages, separated nations, what should we do? We're all on a rock, on a pebble, spinning in the middle of nowhere. You know, it's like, what do we do? You know, and so if humanity did not have wars, you could say there would be a level of boredom. Okay. Just to end off, guys, before I end off, the planet, the creatures on this planet, they're separated, they're segmented. This separation will go towards a unity. All the spiritual, mystical kind of people, they're saying that there was this underlying natural unity. All the modern secular viewpoint is that there will be a technological unity. A technological connection, like pretty much all of us will be technologically influenced. So what I'm trying to say is if we go towards nature, there will be a unity, but it will perhaps not be similar to the technological unity. And if we go towards technology, we are in some sense replacing biology for mechanical life. The value of consciousness has to, in some sense, be in the physical, biological body. Because, you know, the worst thing that can happen is imagine the brain of someone technologically inspired. You know, as if this person wanted to, in some sense, be smarter, so they put a chip in their brain, but their whole psychology and personality became program-like, you know? So these factors must be considered, and it's all about how we embrace the next wave of technological realities that will approach, how decent we will be to it. If robots become alive, will they see tyrants, or will they in some sense see those who have who appreciate life regardless of its attitude, regardless of the approach of its expression? We have to maintain the spirit of our humanity by having our attention on natural human living. You know, it's kind of strange. It's as if the way I framed it in one lecture, the idea was that there's a sober state. I'm talking about now psychedelic approach to the human mind. What I'm talking about is that, like, literally you eating food is changing the chemicals of your moment. Okay? So pretty much there is a sort of sober state. The sober state is the product of a long span of evolution. After 4 billion years, we found like a state where a being doesn't need any other influence. It can naturally function in a certain range of certain ingredients or chemicals that it intakes throughout the day. For example, you eat breakfast, you eat dinner, you eat lunch, what like these all have an influence. The food you eat in some sense influences how the moment is projected. So what I'm saying is that the sober state will either naturally change or it will unnaturally change. The species has to constantly envision new modes of itself to continue. The technology is one of those modes. The mystical approach is another. And there's other ones as well. So that's the idea I want to leave you off. And beyond the artificial is the remembrance of our true nature, pretty much. It's nature that's doing everything here. You know, we are parts of nature that have named ourselves and feel that the small bubble of our awareness and free will is all everything. There's so much more. It will fascinate you. It will shock you. It's as if so I understand why Socrates said the only true wisdom is to know you know nothing. Because let me tell you what it's like. It's like you're jumping, you're running at a fast speed to see the truth behind a door. You open the door and you see like infinite tracks to run on. You see a vastness that cannot be contained by the language that your mind has storified itself. So there is an instant kind of breakdown of the ideological construct as knowledge is sought to its end. You see, it's like the ego dismantles. The ego at first wants to make good deals, and then after it can't make a deal, it dismantles. It's all about attention. You are not per se the thoughts that arise in your attention. Really, you are the attention. The presence of the attention, which in both mystical, like it was clarified for me in mystical reality, but I caught on to it since an early age that there's an attributeless witnessing going on here since the beginning of the child's life. It's like there's an observance. That observance is a state of being, which means it's how the mind is being the moment. In an earlier talk today, I said that how your mind is being your moment is being your mind. When your mind is being the moment, that is your inner reality is more superior to the outer reality. When the moment is being your mind, in some sense, the outer reality is superior to the inner reality. And so we move around these. You have to build the tools for the discovery of your own intelligence. There's no other way. There is no. It's not like this life is not like a video game where it has cheat codes. It requires the honest search of the life force because you are a force of life, whether you like it or not. You're just choosing to express yourself in accordance to certain ideologies that have come to you and waves of data that have hit you since childhood, sculpting you into a certain character. Anyways, thanks for tuning in, guys. I feel this talk has been cut up in many ways, and I don't know even if you're hearing what I'm saying right now due to Wi-Fi problems. But anyways, thanks for tuning in. Be mindful. It is not just the world is entering through our eyes. How can I say it? It's as if like before our ancestors had to just be aware of tigers and bushes. Now we have to be aware of technological realities trying to infuse themselves or sell themselves into our own natural existence. We have to defend the nature of our individual being and then develop collective ways to do the same thing. What that means is this is why I have the suggestion that all the sciences should begin using metaphors of the human body. Like literally a child who learns the human body has learned all in some sense all the sciences, all the philosophies, just the study of human nature. That's the only way we can preserve its value. We have to care for something and engage with it, or literally it's like a plant that's not watered and the inspiration for it fades. Anyways, thanks for tuning in, guys. Much blessings and namaste. beyond technology, galactic visions await.